indeed, ladies and gentlemen. Today we're talking about identical twins. We're trying to find out a bit more about that incredibly close relationship. So close that sometimes they seem psychically linked. But can that also be a problem? Take, for instance, Dave and Danny Girton and Danny's wife, Linda. Danny, how do you three get on?
Three of us?
Yeah.
We've gone pretty well, really. We've parted up a bit. If he's a few hundred miles away, we get on better, really, as far as she's concerned. But
Linda, you prefer it when they're separate?
Yes, because I can have Danny to myself, sort of thing, you know, and we get on with our lives, yeah. So
that's selfish, really, isn't it?
Well, not really. No. Yeah, but so we decided to move away from each other, you know, so I've dragged him away 200 miles away from him. So.
Away from Dave?
Yes.
Did Dave mind?
Yes, he did. Oh, yeah. Yes, he didn't believe that we were going to do that. Yes.
I think the problem is, yeah. It isn't so much, Linda, it's of course with Dave. I mean, I think, thinking back now, we've been away for 2 weeks together.
Where?
And we went to Spain, through France and Spain.
First time for what?
I don't know, 20-odd years, I should think, together.
And that was just Dave
just
and Danny?
Yeah, because we'd been rowing a bit about things. And
who'd been rowing?
Well, me and Linda, really, because he rings up and I'm frustrated. And I felt, when all the time I was away,
yeah.
I was a bit under the weather because I didn't realise until I got back he'd been depressed, very, very depressed. And I was depressed and I suppose any little
he
thing she
depressed.
Said, just as
I was,
exactly.
She was
never
asking
been
me.
In my life.
Asking me, all right?
Go on then. Go on then.
So what happened was really was that we do ring each other, and the only way I've been okay for 7 years because I did cabaret 5 nights a week, you know, around in Sussex where we moved to.
Yeah, I've got it.
And I was very popular.
So I'll just explain that. We were all living together 6 years ago, and then we moved away to.
You were living together, three of them
were
in the same village.
We were in the same village.
In the same village.
Yes, and then
we did our own thing, bringing
the
children
away. So that's
I mean,
why.
Basically, Dave. I mean, he's softer than me. He's brought his family up, and he's wonderful with kids and that. But the thing is, with us, if I go to his house, it's very hard to explain. Any twins will understand what we're talking about, won't you? Your twins, you'll understand. Mm. I'm sure you two will. We don't love him more. How can I love him more than a woman? A woman and man is meant to be, isn't it? But you've got to have some space, you know. It's weird. I can't really explain it. I'm sure you can.
Dave.
So I can't get any space with him. So if I'm with him,
yeah.
With Dave, Linda will come in, you know, no trouble at all. But if he doesn't say so or respond, she might slam her door and say, I said, well, what's the matter? You know, she may say, well, look, he didn't say thank you. Well, we're engrossed. We haven't been together. So
now, listen,
we're talking.
Your twin hasn't said anything yet.
No, he's not allowed to.
No.
Esther, I would be saying the same sort of thing as he was saying it, but I've learned to button up, you know.
What was
this? To be quiet, because otherwise it would drive you crazy, because we're both talking at once. And
that's very difficult.
You wouldn't hear. And I've cottoned on to it after all these years. Now I'm getting on.
So he does the speaking for you both?
Just a second.
I'm noisier than him on my own.
Uh-huh.
Because, you see, when he moved away, we're harmony singers. When he moved away, I couldn't sing anymore.
No, he couldn't.
So I've had to learn to sing again.
So I left. I'm a lead singer. We're harmony singers.
Man.
Are you professional singers?
Well, we are now, but we've gone from cabaret. I've gone into sort of. But I was the lead, so it's more easy for me. Dave is a harmony, so he leads
and I take over.
So now we get together and we can't sing that well together because the.
I can't sing, but
he's leading and I'm leading, so.
Let me take you back through the years to when you first met Linda.
Yeah.
Who first met Linda?
I first met her. Right. Well, together. Yeah. We were together at the time.
Yes. Well, they
how did you choose who to fall in love with?
I noticed they were together, you know.
I was out one night, but
he came up, Danny approached me, you know.
I wasn't looking for a noisy person, because I had a few of
I didn't realise at then what it would be like being married to a twin.
What happened on your wedding?
Yes, well, that's it. When we got married, you know, he even wanted to cut the cake as well.
He cut the cake? Why you weren't married to?
Yeah, so that was the beginning.
Were there warning bells at this stage?
Yes, I think a little bit, but I was very young then, you know, and of course you don't.
You realise as you get older.
But, now, Dave, forgive me. You're not supposed to cut the cake if someone else is getting married.
Yes, but hang on. She's talking to me. Look, the position is, Esther, But when you have a birthday or a wedding and things like that, when you cut the cake, what do you do?
You sing happy birthday.
Do you wish?
You wish.
So, well, I wanted to wish happiness for the pair of them, so I thought, if I put me
on
the cake,
he's never told me that.
In my life, that's the right. That's all there was in it. Into it. That's all. Because if he's happy, I'm happy, OK? But, and the vice versa. But when he's miserable, as I was saying to him about the day when he was depressed, we've never, honestly, people say, oh, I want to do this and I want to do that. I don't understand what they're talking about because I've never, ever been. I'm not. Honestly,
but you got depressed when Linda separated.
I've never been depressed, but
yes, well, we were always living near each other,
right.
And you know, and then I decided because I wanted to move to Sussex, you know, to be near my family, and my children were growing up.
So couldn't Dave have come down south?
Well, no, all his family were settled. Once they get into schools and things, it's difficult, and. Meeting people, so we moved away, and of course, once you're established, you know, and everything, and your children meet their partners, and that's it. So we've been apart ever since, but I prefer it that way.
Because?
Well, because we've got our own life, you know, and but just recently,
Nothing is forever.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say.
And all you want to do, if you're not happy, forget it. You've got to be happy. But I mean. I don't want you to be happy at somebody else's expense. You've got to be. Be all happy.
How long are you going to be in Spain together without Linda?
Well, we haven't made up our minds.
I reluctantly let them go. You know, they wanted the first time in their lives. You know, I've had him for 6 years. So I said, right, you know, let them go off for a couple of weeks.
All our children.
It's not. We haven't gone away. Get it right. I mean, look, there's lots of beautiful women.
We need a break.
I really haven't gone away.
We need.
I don't want to go with any other women. I'll take you. Anybody where I come
from. But Linda isn't jealous of any other women.
No, it isn't that.
I've not even thought about that.
There's nothing wrong with us.
No.
It's just that we want some space because we're not happy. It's fairly happy. But of course, obviously, it's terrible when she rings
every
me up.
Every time I ring, if I ring him up, right, and he doesn't happen to answer the phone, Linda will ring the phone, and I say, oh, it's your brother.
No, not really.
I mean, there's no need for that. I mean, what am I doing? I'm afraid to ring me umbrella. I mean, it shouldn't be.
Well,
like
he only rings nearly every day.
And it's the same.
Again.
With anybody that if I go out.
But the thing, on the other hand, I used to ring when you was with your which I think he very much still loves her. I think obviously.
Yeah,
well,
but
when you were with your wife,
yes.
Are you separated now?
Yes, yes.
But I see my children every
was that
show this week.
It's my turn. what I was going to say was, I think I did, since we've been away,
you did it your
we've
way.
Never really talked together. And he said, well, look, you know, I see you interfered. Just don't say anything. Just gives you a cup of tea.
What about you spending 6 months with him and 6 months with her?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't think of that. That was beautiful.
Linda, what do you think about that?
Well,
that's what we're doing now.
That's what we're going to do now.
It'd be a good idea.
I'm quite enjoying it at the moment. You know, I've had 2 weeks and it's nice and peaceful at home. It's lovely. And I can sort of do what I like. So I'm quite, you know.
Well, think about that for a moment. Because we've got two more twins. Obviously, we've got a studio full of twins here, but now, you two gentlemen, you work together, is that right?
Yes.
You are both headmasters of the same school?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. And one of you is married?
Yes.
Yes. Tim is married to Prue?
Yes.
Right. And Nick isn't married?
That's right.
Okay. So it's a similar sort of... Yes. Do you recognise any of this?
I understand lots of what they say, yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Does Prue get... annoyed about your closeness to your brother?
No. I think it's more fun having two of them.
Perhaps we're not. I mean, we don't ring each other every day.
Yes.
Because they work together.
I see him every day.
Yes. So they don't have to ring each other. Well, that's another solution. Yeah. And Prue says she's got twice the number that she would otherwise. I mean, you've got two of them. Have you thought about it that way?
Well, the family's fine. I mean, the family, the kids, when they go to school, they used to get good ideas.
So they're missing out as well.
And we said, why is that? He said, well, all I said, was my daughter said, she said, well, all I said to this other girl was that I've got two dads. And the girl slapped her around the face and said, I haven't got one. So, she used to bully her. And
well, what, suppose
when
Linda...
When we turned up to school to pick them up.
Yes.
You know, when we was all together, pick them up. All these girls that were bullies were no bullies anymore. Because we said, come here, you, shake hands. Okay, we're very good with children, because we had a terrible childhood.
Oh, yeah.
I think maybe this is why we're not so good. It's like his this relationship. I ruined that because any time they had a row, I heard a lot of, because she's noisy.
You ruined Linda, his marriage.
I think I ruined
it. You see, can I just say something to you technically?
Out.
You're so used to finishing each other's sentences that
I'm not.
I'm not entirely sure.
I think I did
sure.
spoil cause a lot of trouble.
Can I ask the question?
Yeah, sorry.
How, I mean, does Linda feel she's got two husbands? And wouldn't that be more fun even than one?
Well, no, I don't. Dave to me is totally, you know, totally different personality. So, you
well,
know, I don't fancy him at all, really. Not long at all, no. You know, I can't think of
it. No. But look, how can you... No, if so, in dim light, you know, there they are, dressed identically. Who bought those wonderful jacket things?
Well, he bought these acts. Or was it me who bought them? I can't remember.
Well, one or other, anyway.
I paid for them, yeah, and he bought them.
But in dim light.
And Dave would just wear it, you know. He's quite happy. He buys two. And Dave likes it straight away, and they both
we've got the same
like
tastes.
To wear the same.
But in dim light, I mean, they're so similar. Yeah. Do you fancy one? I'm not suggesting anything, but I'm just saying...
No, they're just totally different personalities, really. I'm just... Well, what's the word
it is? which brother did you meet first?
Well, I met Tim first. Apparently they were both at the same party, but I didn't realise he was as a twin for a bit.
I see. And when you discovered that he did have a twin, was that confusing at all?
Not really, no. I mean, it was quite difficult to tell them apart if they were dressed in cricket clothes or dinner jackets or something.
Did you tend to dress alike?
Yes.
I mean, you're not dressed identically, but you are dressed rather similarly.
Because this is what we wear every day.
Isn't that interesting? Sort of nice green tweed. Did you buy the jackets together?
No, I don't think so.
And they aren't, but they're ever so close. And the nice hanky popping up the top.
Thank you.
Do they always do this?
They don't dress identically. I mean, I much prefer it when they do look a little bit different, but inevitably, sometimes they get up in the same tie or something.
Do they? What about parents at the school? Do they get mixed up?
For a bit, yes. Yeah. But that's useful.
Yes, I can see that.
That's useful.
And the children, do they get mixed up?
When they first come.
Yeah.
It takes them about a term to get us sorted out, I think.
And is that also useful?
Can be.
You see, this is the other wonderful thing that twins can do. I mean, they can use this. They can play terrible jokes like Matt and Tim here. Tell us what terrible jokes you have played in your time. Matt.
Well, you can start and I'll finish.
Go on.
There was a time I'm going back about 22 years, when the soul scene was on. Everyone was into soul, 1978-79. And everybody, well, all the guys that we knew, were having these perms, corkscrew perms. So that particular time I said to my brother, why don't we go and have our hair sorted, and what we'll do for a laugh, you go in first, get the lady to have it all sorted for you, and then once you've come out, I'll go in and complain.
So?
Well, at which point he had it done, he paid the lady and gave her a nice tip, and he's come out, I've gone in, and the lady was busy cutting someone else's hair, and I've gone, what have you done to me? And she's just spun around and gone, because my hair's down here now, and he's had this corkscrew, so I've got long hair, and she's gone, I don't know, what? I go, you don't know, I've gone out for half an hour, the wind's got into my hair, my curls are gone, it's dead straight flat, I want it done again. And she goes, but I've been a hairstylist for 35 years. I just can't understand this. I goes, well, something's gone wrong because I'm not leaving until I've got my hair done. So she goes, wait a minute, I just called my assistant. And she called out Leo, and he's walked over, and she's gone, did you use the right formula for his hair? Well, I used all the right stuff. I've been here 5 years with you. How can you question my techniques and that? So once she finished, I said, I'd like to make... No, I don't want your money. I goes, no, please take it. And there's a tip, because I'd like to introduce you to someone. I'll be back in 5 minutes. At which point, I went and got my twin brother. And as we walked in, we both said, hi, and she just looked and went... And this lady just dropped on the floor in hysterical laughter. And then the guy, Leo, he's just walked out and go, two of them.
Two
Very funny. What about women in your life?
Ah, well, there was one time, and I mention only one time, that we swapped my girlfriend. He swapped with me.
Explain to us the situation.
Well, what it was, I just split up with a girl, and I was feeling low, and this girl, I knew her, she really fancied me. Well, anyway. And I went out with her for one Saturday night. But I kept thinking about my old girlfriend. So I said to my twin brother, look, I like her, but I don't want to go out with her, and I don't want to upset her. So do me this favour. And, you know, you go in my place. And so he basically said to me, well, what did you talk about last week? What drinks does she like? Which I explained to him. And then when we went to the club that Saturday, she was waiting over at the bar, and I goes, there she is, just do your bit. So I'll let you take over.
So I've just walked up to her, oh, hello, Carrie, how you doing? You want to drink that old Pernod Black, please, mate? With bitter nice. Yeah, lovely. How was it last week? We had a good time, yeah? Yeah, it was great. We'll have to do it again, won't we? Yeah, yeah. So I ended up going with her for at least 3 to 4 months, and I thought, I've had enough of this. I've got to stop as well. So one evening at the club, I've said, look, I've got to say something, and I won't blame you for whatever you're going to call me after I've said what I've got to say. What? I goes, listen, it wasn't me that went out with you in the beginning, it was my twin brother. Now here I am thinking I'm going to get a girl that's gone into a mad rage and start slapping me about, pulling my hair. She literally started laughing, told all her friends, her mother, and I think that was when the actual relationship finished there.
I'm just trying to think why she wasn't cross with you.
She probably found it amusing.
I think
after
she had
she
a really good
it.
Sense of humour.
Yes, I mean, it's quite funny. It is quite funny.
And we've done quite a few, well, not in the sense swapping girls all the time, because we respect our fellow opposite sex, you know what I mean? We wouldn't do that all the time, would we?
I don't know about you.
So you get on very well.
Yeah, we do.
Very close. Yeah.
Now, are you married?
Yes.
Yeah. Obviously, to different...
Yes.
Of course. Do you find any problems? I mean, do your wives find any problems?
Because, I suppose most twins are close, but
yes.
I keep phoning my brother up, or he'll phone me.
Every day?
Every day, three times a day, or, you know, in the evening. And my wife seems to think I spend too much time with my brother. Mm. She said you to be joined by the hip, you know, being that you're always phoning him up or meeting him and so forth. And I try to explain to my wife, this is a special thing I've got with a twin. Twins are special. Mm. And you've got to understand that I can't just sort of break away completely.
Yeah.
And not as, I mean, I love my wife dearly and everything, but I've got to be in touch with my brother as well at the same time.
Well, you see, this is what's driving Linda nuts, the fact that, you
know... Yeah, I mean, my wife does get annoyed. We do have some blazing rows about
it. But having said that, my partner totally understands.
I suppose it's a matter of... Is it a matter of security, that if you feel absolutely secure in a relationship, you don't feel threatened by that friendship? But if you are concerned about your own relationship, is that unfair, Linda?
Well, I mean, it's a bit different in our situation, because I feel now, you know, I've sort of given in a little bit to Dave, taking Danny away, you know, 200 miles away, and we've been together for 6 years, and I think, oh, well, I agreed that they could go away, you know, for a little while together, so I didn't argue about it. So
yeah,
I'm
that.
Just, because you know, we've been married 26 years, so I mean, it's about time, you know, I've given in, and they can have a little holiday together, so I haven't really objected.
I really took Dave away, really, this time.
Yeah,
so.
Well, it's 50-50.
Right, well, meet Lizzie. Now, Lizzie is a twin, and you've been through this, if you like, and you came to a very interesting decision, didn't you? Tell us.
Yeah, well, I hadn't had a day apart until I was 20, then 19, and I'd always been to the same school, did same O-levels, same A-levels, and went to the same university.
And your twin, her name is
Louie,
and she's identical.
Yeah, exactly the same. Yeah. And we arrived at university, and we did our first year. That was fine, we were doing the same subject. So we didn't really think for ourselves. And suddenly after the first year, we decided we'd try and go our separate ways. And we decided to live in separate cottages. And I was actually dreading it. And I, from the age of about 10, I used to think, this is going to be the most frightening time of my life, to sort of go our separate ways. But at the same time, I really wanted to do it. And at the beginning of that second year, she went one way and I went the other. And it was really the first time we'd ever had apart for any length of time.
How did you feel?
Terrified.
Mm. Did it get better as time went by?
Yes, it did. But to start with, it was very difficult. And I knew that, looking back on the fact that the first 20 years of our life, we'd been together so much, that it was going to take me probably 10 years to know what it was like to be a single person.
And did it?
10 years.
Did it?
And now I've had 10 years as a single person. Yeah. So I very much look at it as my double life, my middle phase and my independent phase.
And is she married? Are you married?
She's done everything before me. Yeah, we're both married. Yeah. And both got 3 children. But we have the most wonderful relationship now as separate people.
Now, what about the speaking to each other every day and that sort of thing? Do you do that?
Not every day. We speak probably twice a week. I think we both have very busy lives, and when she's out with her 3 children, and I'm doing exactly the same, so she's not always there to speak to.
Do your husbands feel in any way threatened by your closeness?
No.
Not?
I think one of the most important things for me was to have a happy marriage. I wanted to have grown apart from my twin sister. And I knew I needed to do that to really feel that I could have a happy marriage.
So you felt you had to separate first?
Yes.
That's interesting,
yep.
Isn't it?
Well, I really wanted to. And from when it happened, when I was 19, and I probably cried every day for a year as I was trying to go through the separation. Mm. But then it was worth doing it, because when I was 30, I knew I'd done it.
It sounds really painful experience for
you,
to cry every day.
No, it was very painful.
Yes.
But I wanted to do it.
Yes. Do you think that...
I can't believe it. I can't believe what I'm hearing. I mean, how could you lose? Now, I mean, Esther, I don't know if you've got... You must have a best friend in life.
Sure.
Yeah. But that wouldn't replace... This is my best friend. I mean, his mother, his father, his uncle, his auntie. If he's got a problem, I've got a problem.
It's like looking in the mirror.
He doesn't have to listen to me. I can say, do it this way. And Dave will say, no, I'm doing it my way. He'll do it his way. And I'll say, well, I better not say I told you so.
So we're working out together. He'll squabble. We'll have a squabble.
How can I do what?
Well, separate yourself.
I can have something there that's identical to you.
I mean,
you've got something there. He's your best friend.
Best friend.
But we still are.
Your mother and father, though. You've got your mother and father and everybody in her.
We still are best friends.
Yeah.
But we don't have to live in each other's pockets.
Yeah, but you've lost something.
Why?
You've lost something.
Get in
there. No, we haven't. We haven't lost something.
Right, we've got some more twins here. Listening to this, what do you feel?
I think it's brilliant what they did. Absolutely brilliant. I mean, you know, you go through your life and get so sick of people seeing you as one package, basically. And to do that, I mean...
But you work together, don't you?
Yeah, we have done. But then we've had separate jobs as well, and you know, it's the twin thing. You can use it to your advantage, I suppose.
I think
we've got it.
I think the viewers would quite like to see you working together, because it's quite spectacular. Fantastic heads for heights.
Yeah, that's never bothered us at all. Always like the fast roller coasters and things.
Yeah. And you're both dancers, are you?
Yep.
Are you competitive? I mean, what happens if you both audition for one job?
Well, this is what happened when we actually both started university. Mm-hmm. I actually was accepted and Rachel wasn't. It's a degree in performing arts, and it's...
We both grown up doing the same thing, didn't we?
Yeah.
If ballet lessons when you're three, you know, our mum wouldn't put one of us there and the other one not.
No.
And we just happened to both want to carry it on. So I didn't get in the first year of university, and Lorna did. So there was not even a question, was there? You just went.
Yeah, I went. I mean, it was really, really difficult because I knew that Rachel wanted to go. Rachel wanted to be there.
Are you different standards?
No, not really. No. I mean, I'll finish in May. It's only like a year behind. But it's like it was a blessing in disguise, really.
Was it?
Because, yeah, we like our... You've got to be apart sometimes. And we won't phone each other every day. I don't... No. Sometimes I can't be bothered speaking to you, to be honest. But, we are very, very close.
But maybe you don't
friends.
Have
we are
to...
best friends at the end
but
of the day.
But there's other people that we confide in first, though, isn't there? I confide in somebody else, a close friend of mine, before I confided in Lorna.
Do you ever have psychic moments when you know what each other's thinking, or do you ever?
No, we're not like that.
I think we think the same more than we actually realise. Yes. You know, sometimes you come out with the same thing, or sometimes I'll be thinking something and I'll just suddenly say, "Rach, what are you thinking?"
You have the same thoughts, but it's like that, the thought process. One thing leads to another, as we have known a lot about each other, or a memory of something, you know. And sometimes we come out with the same thing, but you don't know you're thinking the same thing because you don't say it.
Did your parents treat you as different, or were you dressed identically as children?
From a parent's point of view, I found it very difficult to not treat your twins differently, because you've given birth to them at the same time. You know, they're growing up together, and you can't suddenly send one to dance classes and not the other. Do you know why do that?
I had twins, I dressed in this. We were dressed the same with like different colours when we were little, and then as you got older, you just start to wear your own thing.
But it's quite interesting the way you've chosen different things to wear, whereas the men here are absolutely identical, or almost identical. Yeah. It's interesting. Matt, who chose your clothes?
Well, I bought the tops, he bought the trousers.
Right.
We got the shoes at the same time, and the jackets. But we don't dress the same all the time. It's only when we want to have a laugh.
What does that mean again? No, don't tell us. We dare not think. We've got some more twins here. Right, now, you are... Let me get this, because you see, the trouble is, you are rather alike. Ian is married to Sean. That's right. And you're Caris. Yeah. And you're married to Daniel. Mm-hmm. Right, now... Do you think they've picked rather similar-looking men?
Yeah.
Or is it just the hairdos? No, that you are rather similar. You are rather similar, but do you tend to fancy the same kind of man?
I never have. I've never fancied Caris's partners.
Yes.
But Caris has fancied mine.
That one?
That one in particular, yes.
Tell us what happened.
Me and Caris went to work at a hotel during our end of second year at university, and Ian was working there. And we didn't actually tell each other that we fancied him, but I kind of knew she did, and I think she knew that I did. And I had this horrible feeling she was going to do something about it, and I already had a boyfriend that he'd gone off travelling. So I thought, I've got to get in there first, because I knew she was going to do something. So I did. I dropped a note out of a window with my phone number on it. I'd never done anything like that before in my life, but I decided, what the hell, I'll just do it. And I don't think he knew which one of us he was going to be going out with that night.
Did you?
No. I didn't care at the time.
You didn't care. Isn't he interesting? Aren't men interesting? Right. So, but it was the right one. You see, if this were a Shakespeare, you know, you'd end up with the wrong one and there'd be hell to pay. But you went up with the right... Did you mind all this?
Yes. Because I felt it was unfair. She already had a boyfriend. I didn't have a boyfriend.
Right.
So I thought, this is unfair. I like him as well. And now she's got two boyfriends. And I haven't even got one. So I was, the first time Ian met me, I think he thought I was a bit of a psycho because I was just very upset, and he couldn't understand why I was upset, and I was very moody towards him. And I don't think he realised why. I think he thought he'd offended me, and he hadn't even met me properly. But it was just because I was upset. And I also couldn't speak to Sean for a while, because I kept threatening to tell her boyfriend at the time. And it wasn't because I wanted to sort of grass her up.
She was too charming here.
Yes, I thought it was really unfair, but it was only because I liked him as well, so I just thought, you know.
Well, what happened when you met Daniel?
Well, we actually met before that.
Yes.
Sean and Ian met.
but we were taking a break at the time, as people say.
On a break, I know the phrase. My sympathy has somehow diminished, have you noticed? No, I was feeling all sorry for you until I realised that you had a gentleman friend too in your armpit.
Well, I did, but it wasn't our choice that we were taking a break. It wasn't my choice that we were taking a break. So your sympathy needs to shift to me.
Yes, yes. I'm back with you
that's
again.
That's a different show, Esther. So
yes, of course. But do come back another time, because we'd like to do that show. That's excellent. So now all's well that ended well. Do you find that these two are very close?
Yes. They're very different in their personalities.
Yeah.
They may look the same. They've tried for the last 10 years to have different jobs, to live in different places, different schools, but they've always ended up same school, same college, same jobs. And now
same jobs now?
Yeah, and now we're living in the same street. So it's like you're sharing your relationship with someone else.
You'd have to get used to that.
Yes, yeah. Because we've heard it can be a bit stressful. Yeah. So what's your way of coping?
I think you've got to be fairly laid back. As soon as I met Sean and we went out at first, early on you realised that it was almost like going out with two people. And if I didn't get on with Karis, then I know I'd be in trouble. So that's why I was, you know, quite concerned at the beginning. I thought I'd done something wrong or whatever. But, you know, it's better.
You like it?
Yeah,
two
I do.
For the price of one?
Yeah, definitely.
And you don't care which it is? Do you care now?
I do care now.
Oh, that's good. Have there been moments when they've been almost too close? I mean, when you got pregnant, who did you tell first?
That wasn't intentional. I was flying at the time, and I did the
pregnancy test. Because you're an air stewardess.
Yes, and I was in New York, and I'd bought it from around the corner from the hotel, and Karis happened to be there. And I didn't think it was going to be positive anyway, so I just thought, I'll just do it. Karis is here. Yeah. And then it came out positive, and I thought, oops. And I knew he'd be cross, that he wasn't the first to know. But he took it very well.
But couldn't you have fudged it a little? Why did he have to know that you'd told your twin?
Well, I was
There's
so...
There's no secrets.
No.
No secrets.
I knew it would come out. I knew if I lied, it would come out eventually, because she would tell him the truth.
How did you feel when you realised that she'd told her sister before you knew?
I always thought she would do. So that I made a point beforehand of saying, you must tell me first. But I kind of knew that she wouldn't do, so I wasn't surprised.
Yes, right. Well, we've talked a bit about, obviously, the effects on one's marriage and so on, but we haven't really gone into the business of working with one's twin. And, of course, some twins famously work together. Norris McWhirter and his twin, Ross, created the Guinness Book of Records and appeared together on Record Breakers until Ross was tragically murdered. Until that time, they were together throughout their working lives, went to the same college, were married the same year, mastered the most extraordinary facts. And this is how you will remember they appeared with the late Roy Castle in 1973.
Jack Leary of Los Angeles had an attack of hiccups which lasted from the 13th of June 1948 to the 1st of June 1956. During that 8-year span, his weight was reduced from 9 stone 11 to 5 stone 4. And it's estimated that he had a total number of 160 million hicks. And he had 60,000 suggestions of cures, but only one of them worked. A prayer to St. Jude, the patron saint of lost causes. And that, of course, was a
record breaker.
You're obviously really close to Ross, Norris.
Yes, very, very close. And I always enjoyed being a twin. And we used to be sorry for people who weren't twins.
And what about, we've heard the pressure on relationships, on marriages and so on. Did that ever occur in your lives?
Not at all, no. Though, curiously enough, my wife, who died some years ago, she and my sister-in-law were mistaken in shops by people they didn't know for being sisters. So we both obviously had rather the same taste.
You're both great sportsmen.
What about great sportsmen? We used to take part in things together, and things we liked best was relay running with baton passing, because if twins, they can practice it. They're the same height, they're always together, and there's no excuse for not getting a perfect takeover. And we won the national title for the 4x110-yard sprint relay. And I think we're the only twins who've done that. But I'm sure other twins would do it if they were around.
Now, obviously, we've talked about the tragic death of your brother.
Yeah.
How did you hear about it?
I was rung up by the police. Yeah. And they told me to... I was 6 miles away at the time. And I realised straight away there's no chance of his surviving. And I liken it more to an amputation than a bereavement, because if you're very close to somebody and genetically the same person, it's like losing part of you. Yeah. And that was the effect.
And is it still for you like an amputation? Do you still feel that your brother's with you?
Well, I think about him every day, because our work was so close together, and I'm still doing the same sort of work on facts and figures, and I keep on coming across notes and things that he made, and then sometimes I think, well, he would have known that, because he was particularly expert in some fields, and we divided things up a bit. And so it's, I haven't forgotten it, and time has an effect, but you never forget.
Well, Naomi, who's sitting next to you, has been through the same experience, haven't you? Tell us how that happened.
A lot of what Norris is saying rings very true. My sister Rachel died 3 years ago of a very rare cancer in her sinuses, which she had for 3 years. And I think you're completely right when you say it's like an amputation. You have to learn to be a single person, which you just don't have any experience of. So it's almost like a rebirth. It's quite odd.
You have to either positive and do twice as much work, or you'd be negative and give in. And I think it's much better to be positive, and that's obviously what you've done.
Well, when you see someone go through cancer, you can't just then give in and say, oh, poor me, I've lost my sister. I would have felt that I was letting her down. And right near the end, she said to me, you've got to live your life for both of us. And I thought, yes, that's true, but I've got to live my life for as I would live it for both of us, not as she would live it. But you owe it to both of you to keep on going.
Do you feel that, Norris, that you absolutely are living your life for both of you, in a sense?
Yes, absolutely, yes. I do things because sometimes I think he would have liked me to have done them, and he would have done them too. Mm. So I think that's perhaps the best reaction.
Mm. It can make you brave in time and do things that maybe you wouldn't have had the confidence to do before.
Like what?
Just if you were going to golf and do a particular course, or just launch into... And Rachel was a real keen triathlete, and I was probably a bit more of a wimp, but now I think, oh, well, I'll give things a go, because she'd have given it a go, and she just wouldn't be standing on the edge of the swimming pool going, oh, it's really cold. You know, she'd have been in there, so you just make yourself do other things.
Did you have this sort of psychic link that one sometimes hears about?
It's not a psychic link. You understand how someone makes sense of the world, so you can understand what their reactions will be. But when Rachel was sick, I was on holiday with my fiancé in France, and she went in for an emergency operation on her head. And the time that she actually had surgery, I got a massive migraine. And I remember he was out surfing. I had to sit in the car with a sweatshirt over my head for 5 hours or something. And it was only when we got back that I actually realised that was exactly when she'd had the surgery. And I could tell when she was having a panic attack in the middle of the night when she was sick, because I'd wake up and about 2 minutes later she'd phone. So it's an awareness, but it's not telepathy.
Did she ever express to you then, and were you able to express to her how you felt about each other before you asked her?
Right at the end, when she was in the hospice about 2 days before she died, she just said, as a very matter-of-fact way, I really love you. Well, no, she didn't say really, she said, I love you. And I sort of thought, oh, right, I love you too. And I felt a bit flustered about the reaction. And actually, she didn't have to dress it up, because it's a totally understood thing. There isn't anything more than that. And that's what she was saying was actually what life's about. And I guess that just sums it up. And you can understand enough in that relationship that that is all that matters.
Now, she died just before your marriage, your wedding.
10 days.
10 days. Mm-hmm. Did you ever feel I can't go through with this now without her?
No, the opposite, actually, because quite a lot of people said, don't get married, put it off. I think they probably thought it's going to be difficult for our parents, probably that I'd find it difficult. But she would have had a fit. There's no way, roles reversed. She would have hated to have to cancel her wedding, and she wouldn't have wanted me to. And actually, it was a lovely wedding, because you could sense her there, and it was a very, loving event. So it was the right thing to do for me.
Has it made you frightened of death yourself?
No, the opposite, exact opposite. Really? In terms of shared experiences, when she died, it sounds a bit weird, but everything went golden and we both went up and she kept going and I didn't. And it's very nice. The actual having cancer and being ill and that bit of dying is horrible, but death itself is really nice. So in a way that's a gift for me because, you know, at 28, to know that when you end this life it's actually a nice way to, a nice experience, is a very sort of freeing gift.
Was that in the hospice?
Yes. Yeah.
Were you alone together?
And my mum. Yeah.
Golden.
Not like a colour, just like sort of like glitter you have when you're at nursery school, and you just like everyone had thrown that up.
So your memories are happy.
It's a very difficult time. And I think part of when you're a twin, you unconditionally feel that you are there for somebody, and it's non-optional. You can't say, "Oh, I'm really tired. I'm not going to come." Into hospital to see you, and so it was a very fraught time, because also if you're going through cancer you take it out on the person that you know is going to be there and take all your emotions. So it was very difficult for me in that way, and also because she was having an experience that I couldn't relate to. Her experience of pain was nothing that I would ever understand or couldn't understand now, and so that began the sort of separation process, as Lizzie was talking about. And that's why I think what Lizzie went through is so valuable, because if we had been completely, we weren't dressed the same, if we'd been dressed the same, made to be very similar people, I don't know how I would have coped, but we were close, but we weren't inseparable.
Now, Tracy, you also have been through the experience of cancer, and what was it like for you both?
Awful.
Awful, yeah.
Did you experience the pain together through it?
No, I think it was worse for Dawn, because she couldn't understand what I was going through, but you've got to treat it like a cold. I know it sounds a bit callous, but you've got to treat it like a cold. You can't think, oh my goodness, I've got cancer, I'm going to die. You've got to just think, cancer, I'll get over it.
That's not easy. What I mean. That's not easy.
No, it's not.
You have your moments, obviously, of fear. You must have.
Oh, lots of them. You get swamped by fear. You're just overwhelmed by it.
But there's your sister who loves you so much.
Yeah.
Was she taken down by the same fear?
Yes, but I didn't let her know. Because you have to be strong for her. So I tended to be really strong for Tracy, and then I'd hide it. If she mentioned anything worse than getting through it, I'd say, don't be so stupid, you are going to be fine. Nothing will happen to you. And then I'd go and think, oh, God. It was awful.
Did you feel you'd be letting her down if you said, oh, it is really awful?
Yeah.
I thought exactly the same. You couldn't say, yes, you might die.
No, you can't say that. That's something you cannot say.
In fact, I used to keep saying, I'm going to die, ain't I? And I'd say, don't be stupid. And I'd say, I know I am.
Yeah.
And she'd just like...
You'd make light of it in the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, whatever. But it's not like that. I mean, that's what you'd say, but it isn't like that. But it is to her.
Now, it was breast cancer breast cancer, as we know, is now treatable, and you're looking absolutely terrific. But it wasn't all that long after your illness that Dawn had a scare. Now, tell us about that.
Well, I went to the doctor, and they told me I had a lump, which I didn't. It wasn't anything. It was the wrong time of the month. But they sent me to the hospital. And I had to wait for a mammogram, but it was fine. But now I have regular checkups because of the genetic side.
Presumably the doctor must have been influenced by the fact that you were twins.
Yes, it was the hospital that put us onto it. Yeah, it was through them that we got onto it, wasn't it?
Yeah.
The genetic side.
So what do you feel, in a sense, you've learned from this experience?
I couldn't have got through it without Dawn. Because I used to take everything out on her, and it's awful, but I did. I used to take it all out on Dawn, and she'd just take it up like a sponge. She was brilliant.
That's how I went home and took it out on my ex.
Yeah.
It was going down the line.
You see, this is the thing. I mean, listening to all the stories we've heard so far, one does feel envious of this marvellous closeness, this best friend, but the price of it is that you almost become each other's life support system. And this is why, in a sense, Lizzie's experience is so interesting, having deliberately torn herself away from it, almost as if you knew.
We are still very good friends.
Yes.
And we still have that wonderful friendship.
Yes.
Get on brilliantly. But we've also got our own separate lives and aren't quite so needy as we used to be.
I think
yes.
when you're a twin
yeah.
and it's kind of the worry. Is that what you were thinking the same thing?
Excuse me, she had so much interest. How can you deny a psychic link?
I got in there first. Say,
of course you knew, and she knew you knew.
Isn't that's it why eerie? I had to get in there first, you see. Yeah.
Yes, okay, well, the rest of us aren't quite sure what you're talking about. Do you mind finishing the sentence?
Well, it's just, you say you're doing exams at school or anything like that, at the same school, and you're worrying about it. When you've got a twin, it's kind of worrying for two people.
Yes.
Because you want that twin to be doing as well as what you are. So, you know, you're sat in this exam, you're thinking, I hope, you know, it is worried, it's double the worry, because you just can't help it, that's the way it is, you know. And, you're just close.
And it's like, you are best friends, but you've got your own best friends, you know, normal friends. But the closeness between you two is that you can argue, you can slag each other off England, you know, and then you get back, you forget about it, like, half an hour later. Yeah. You forget that you've ever said, you know.
I always say that if the whole world turned against you, everybody, and even if your twin thought you were wrong as well, they'd still stick by you.
Yeah.
And that's what it's like having a twin. They'll always be there for you.
That can be really annoying. It's annoying though sometimes.
To do better than you.
That's the thing. That's
don't you think you're happy when she does very well?
Yeah, that's the thing. When I got in, when I didn't get in university and Lorna did, it was worse for her going.
Absolutely.
Because she knew that I wanted to be there as well. And I was fine about it. And she felt guilty about going. I was like, just, you know, that's life, isn't it?
He did better than I did.
Yeah. It's just life and you just have to accept it.
So it's a sort of protective thing.
Yeah.
Now, Barbara, there are more and more twins being born, you know, as a consequence of IVF and other things.
Yeah.
That multiple births is a rather peculiar technological term for it all, isn't it?
It is, yeah, and that covers twins, triplets and more, so it's the
and we're hearing about this closeness, the strength of this closeness, but we're also hearing the pain of the closeness.
Yes, yeah. And I think it is particularly difficult for surviving twins, obviously, as we've heard from Norris and Naomi. But, you know, very often when twins come to have a separation that's caused by something other than a death in between them, that can cause great difficulties as well, as we've heard from the couples here that find it very difficult to lead entirely separate lives.
What do you think about the solution of Danny and Dave going away for a few months together?
I'm not sure they're going to come back.
Oh dear. Now, let me just introduce you to Margaret and Jenny. Now, you were separate for 57 years, is that right?
For 57 years.
57 years.
Yes.
And because you actually didn't realise that you had a twin sister.
No.
And you've only known each other for 3 years. Tell us about the first conversation you had when you realised that you had a twin and you talked to each other for the first time.
Well, I was asked by a lady, would I like to speak to my twin sister?
Yes.
And I said, yes, certainly. So I said, if you can give me a few minutes, I said, to get over the shock that I have got a twin sister. So Jenny rang me in about 5 minutes later. And we had a very nice conversation, didn't we, Jenny? Asking about our families and about our childhood and about our school days.
Now, you grew up in completely different places.
Yes, yes.
Quite different backgrounds, but there are extraordinary similarities in your lives. Go through the coincidences.
Well, we both worked for the BBC, and we both married men who worked for the BBC.
I'm amazed you didn't meet, actually. Were you ever in the same place, the same premises?
Well, we were at one particular stage in our lives. I went up to a broadcasting house with my husband to do a programme, and he was standing behind me in the queue. And he went up to a table, thinking I had got to this table in the canteen, and he went to speak to this person thinking it was me. But in fact, afterwards, I realised now it was Jenny, because he said to me, I've just seen your double. And that was over 30 years ago.
If only he'd spoken.
Yes.
If only he'd spoken.
Yes.
So do you feel as if you've suddenly gained a very close friend?
Oh, yes, I do,
even though you've been strangers for most of your life?
Yes, because it happened at a very good moment for me, because I'd lost my husband, and then I had this telephone call to say I had a twin sister. So it was...
Fill the gap.
Yes, it did.
Fill the gap.
Yes.
What have you done? Your twin sisters, and then one of you have had twin sisters. So what decisions have you made about whether you've...
I'm staying single.
You're single?
Yeah, just in case we have another two. Yeah.
Because you don't want history to repeat itself.
Certainly not, no.
Is she being serious with me?
Yes.
I let her do the hard work, I just get to share.
She gets to share a little bit without any of the work.
Oh, I see. It's not that it was a bad experience having a twin, then?
No, but I sort of did share in that a little bit.
Did you?
I was abroad at the time in the States and had terrible tummy pains, and 3 weeks before my nieces were due to be born, I just had this awareness that I was convinced that my sister had them. Luckily, I told someone this, and when I returned from my trip the next afternoon, there was a message saying, "Hello, Auntie, the girls have been born just after midnight."
How apart? How far apart were you?
Oh, I was in America, and my sister was in Inverness.
So that's telepathy.
So it was quite a long way off.
And it was New Year's Eve, and the twins were born just after midnight, so they were the first babies of 1986.
Yeah. So what have you decided to do? Girls... do you live each other's lives? Are you very, very close?
Yeah, we are quite close.
And are you at all bothered by any of the things you've heard about how it can get in the way of other relationships?
No, I think we've both got boyfriends and they're pretty laid back about it. They don't really mind that we spend quite a lot of time together.
So. Yes, it's interesting, because men don't seem to care. Perhaps women are interchangeable. Now, Anne, you've got twins,
yes, as we
can see.
Yes. My boys, what's worrying me is just now, as a parent of twins, I'm trying to develop their individuality, encourage it. They are very competitive towards each other. And they're always racing, and if you ask them who's best at football, they'll both say, me, it's me.
Who's best at football? Him? Why aren't you best at football?
Because I'm not that good at slide tackling, but I'm good at goals.
Well, that's important in football. Think of David Seaman. Mind you, you're Scottish, so maybe you don't feel as powerful. Right, so they're quite competitive. And can it be double trouble to have twin boys?
Definitely double trouble. I've got a few horror stories.
Tell us.
Set fire to my living room carpet. They've flooded my hall. They've fed my fish with 3 tubs of fish food. Well, my husband's fish, and killed them all. They've actually taken the fish out beforehand, obviously, and washed them in washing powder. It was logical to them.
But I think that's rather kind of you, actually. They might have been grubby. So you washed the fish in washing powder and then fed them a lot of fish food, and they...
A different set of fish.
Oh, different
ones. We renewed the fish because they killed the fish with the washing powder first time. And then my husband replaced the fish and they decided to feed them 3 tubs of fish food.
Do you think they sort of egg each other on in this?
Definitely, yes.
But can't you sort of keep your eye on them?
It's nigh on impossible all the time. They play decoy. Well, more so when they were younger, they played decoy. If they knew that they weren't allowed to do a specific thing, then one would go to a lesser thing, say, for example, turning the television on and off.
Yeah.
One would go to that, while the other one made a quick exit to go and do something else. You know, they played each other off. They worked as a team.
Yes.
I was always a bad one.
But there's a lot of creative energy here, isn't there? I mean,
very much so.
In a sense, you know, they might do great things. I wonder whether Ross and Norris were a bit like this when young.
Oh, yes, we used to. It's fascinating listening. All coming back to me, exactly how it was. And I saw them before the show started fighting each other.
These two?
And it wasn't a vicious fight. It was just like sort of puppies playing together. Yeah. And that's what twins do a lot.
The
hours and hours of day they do it. And
we saw you two doing it.
We haven't stopped.
You two do it.
We haven't stopped.
You haven't stopped.
No.
So you better don't get too depressed about it, perhaps, because maybe they're going to turn out, you know, like the McWhirters and do something really inventive and creative.
Yes.
Mind
you, the best of friends, but the worst of enemies as well. They can be very vicious towards each other, and if I try to step in, I'm the one that gets it from both of them.
Yes, I imagine that. Is it fun having a twin?
Yes.
Do people get mixed up?
Mm-hmm.
sports? A lot?
Yes. Everyone in the school does.
Do they call you the wrong names?
Every single time.
You're Andrew. And you're James. Yes. There, I got it right, didn't I? Do you mind getting mixed up? People getting mixed up? Do you tick them off? Do you tell them? You could have a big T-shirt with Andrew written on it. Would that be useful? Or do you like it when they get mixed up?
I like it when they get mixed up.
Yeah, you see, that's what they say up there. I mean, they played... Did you hear that story about the terrible practical jokes that those two did with the hairdresser? That might be quite fun, might it? What am I doing? What am I doing? Putting ideas in. So you really want to know how to cope with this, do you? What?
Yes, I want to know if there's any hope for me in the future. Because, thanks. They're very lively. I mean, all children are lively and they're very competitive. It's just to know where to draw the line. I mean, are they always going to be this way? Am I ever going to get a respite from it?
Well, look, we've got two head teachers here. Were you like that?
Yes, I think so. No.
So what hope has Anne got? I mean, what should she do?
I think you're
best?
Quite competitive together.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But I think that we weren't competitive with each other. Right. But I would say don't split them up.
I disagree with that.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Go on. Naomi?
We were put in different classes from right early on and dressed very differently, and that was just so helpful because you could get your own identity.
Yes.
And I'm just so glad that, because when we were lumped together, say we were in guides or browners together, we did something, say she did something embarrassing, they'd say, oh, the twins did whatever. I'd think, oh, it's not the twins, it wasn't me. Yes, and it was just so valuable to make your own friends and have your independent time in the day, because you have in the evening and at home you can always have your time together.
Do you like being together at school or do you like being separate?
Separate.
You would prefer to be separate. Well, that's interesting. Were you ever separated, you and Tim?
At school,
you,
yeah. We were.
And was that a help or not?
Well, we used to swap back and forth. But there was one particular teacher, the only way she caught us out was that I write with my right hand and he's left.
Oh, we are.
Oh, really?
It's the only way she caught us up.
So, Norris, tell us, what is the answer? Because, I mean,
I think the answer is that twins are extremely lucky. And they're quite rare. Mm. See, one in every 80 births in this country. And the great thing is to turn twinhood into something highly advantageous. Because you've got a partner for life, a person you can trust 100%. Mm-hmm. And most people don't have that. So what I say is, be grateful for the fact you're a twin, and be happy.
Very good. Well, that's lovely. Well, thank you very much indeed. Congratulations. Congratulations to the twins on having a twin, and to those who've married twins, good luck. Thank you to all our guests. Thank you at home for joining us. Until next time, from everyone here, goodbye.
Esther is recording a programme about drugs. Do you use drugs? Do you have a son or a daughter with a drug habit? If you have lost a child to drugs, call 2 if you have a drug problem. Ring now 84488.
Everybody was attracted by her because she was utterly different.
But she also represented another class, the polar opposite of Vivien Leigh.
I was not the sort of girl who breaks up marriages.
People fall in love, they fall in love. You say, oh yeah, fine.
She said, I'm in a kind of idiot heaven with her.
How Larry met Joan and became Lord and Lady Olivier.
I didn't want to be just one in a long line of leading ladies who'd fallen at his feet.
Omnibus, Saturday at 8 on BBC Two.
Attachment.
I did it. It happened. I regret it.
Loose on Mike.
God, if he knew what went on in my head, he'd have left me years ago.
Mike on Loose.
I'm trying for a baby.
Mike.
Well, we can tell our best friend, surely.
Look at him. Playing happy families all of a sudden.
Kiss.
What about my choice?
Jake on Fran.
You tried to kill yourself, Mike. Even then you couldn't come clean. You keep telling yourself you're the victim.
Fran on Will.
Him and his wife, they're separated. Really, it's because of me.
Attachment. Hard to resist.
Me and my big mouth. Whatever will it say next?
Thursday at 10 on BBC Two.
Your last chance to explore the blue planet, tomorrow at 9 on BBC One. Until now, we've only touched the surface.
Time to get the leathers on in 45 minutes on BBC Two with Anne Robinson pulling out more of the questions for The Weakest Link.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another helping of Ready, Steady, Cook. Today's kitchen kings waiting in the wings are the fabulous Brian Turner. Yeah! And very exciting, Phil Vickery. Yeah! Hello, Brian.
Lovely to see
you. Good.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, very good. And do you travel much around?
Look at my hairline.
I know, you're smiling at another. Why does he smile at you like that?
My grey hair doesn't look. It's coming good. He's stopped putting the stuff in it now, so it looks good now.
That's Nick Nairn. That's not me.
And here's Auntie A.
Yeah, how can you talk about each other like that, putting stuff in your hair?
Yeah.
I don't know. Ladies and gentlemen, today we've got a husband and wife team. They're from Lancashire, so please give them a warm welcome. That's Diane and Mark Edwards.
Hello.
Lovely to see you. Come and join us. Hello, how are you?
I do.
And lovely to see you too. So who's the main cook at home?